Community members in the oldest town in New York State remain appalled that their home was portrayed as a singles playground and a haven for shallow, wealthy partygoers. Skip Haney, Southampton Town Supervisor. In June of 2002, a program called The Hamptons aired on a major television network, and millions of viewers tuned in for a close-up look at real life here on this famous sliver of land. What audiences saw instead was 4 hours of a Hamptons so soulless that it was insulting to the people who live here and work here and vacation here and cry when it's time to leave here. This is a place of such wondrous beauty and natural riches that the Nature Conservancy calls it one of the last 10 great places left in the Western Hemisphere. A magical place that for decades has inspired artists, writers, musicians, and photographers from Walt Whitman to Billy Joel. What you are about to see is the movie that they didn't make, The Real Hamptons. The beautiful landscapes and rich tapestry of people who work and care for their families, contribute to important community needs, and fight to preserve their environment. The Real Hamptons is not the smut that boosts TV ratings. It's for those who are more inspired by National Geographic than the National Enquirer.
I'm Steve Hawili. I'm the president of Word Hampton Public Relations, and very disappointed in the documentary. This documentary did not show any of the real people. We got plenty of real people out here. That's what a community is all about. She didn't touch upon the Latino community. She's got all these weekend folks, these share house people. I mean, this is a smidgen of what this area is all about. It's just it's a shame, man. She didn't get the real people.
You know what? I couldn't wait. The coming attractions were like, oh, the Hamptons, and we couldn't wait because we're not angels.
Just the beauty of the place, the people. I mean, I ride to work every day. I see turtles, herons, opossums. It's a beautiful place.
It definitely neglected the rich history here.
They didn't talk about the real backbone of the Hamptons, what makes it go on.
This is such an incredible place to be.
I kind of say this is, you know, one of the better places on Earth.
You can just simply enjoy and relax.
It's got everything you need.
I couldn't imagine how they could cook something up like that and get it on TV.
The piece that I saw was very offensive.
It's an amazing place full of amazing people, not just desperate, lonely losers.
I thought the show misrepresented the Hamptons, you know, turned it into a nightmare. And the truth is, the Hamptons is everything that show isn't.
Much as I could sit and watch. I think it really challenged a person's intelligence. It just wasn't the Hamptons. You know, it was a small part. We live in probably the most beautiful place in the world. Mm-hmm. Yes, we have Christy Brinkley, and yes, we have Billy Joel. My family called. Mary Jane, what are you doing out there?
What I thought of the show actually was, it's a little bit of a, for instance, when you look at the Hamptons magazine, okay, it's a little bit of, you know, it's got the Hampton magazine, so it's a little bit of the gossip about the Hamptons and the scenes.
Did
and,
you like it?
I thought it showed the real life of people in the Hamptons. You know, we know what our life when we go out and we have fun and we party, but it also showed different people's lives, you know, relaxing and, you know, other parts of the Hamptons that I really never knew people, you know, did. I thought it was a good show.
It was all about money, partying.
And coming out here and partying
meeting
and living the life.
Older men to get married and
yeah.
Have money in a house.
That's like so 90s Hampton. I've been living here for like almost my entire life. And
that's so not what we're all about.
So not at all.
I mean, it wasn't about the people that work hard, the working class. It wasn't at all what was really going
yeah.
on.
There's a lot of different people who live out here, and it really didn't include them in the so-called documentary.
It was definitely a misinterpretation.
Yeah, very much so. They mostly focused on the money and the people who come out here for summer, and that's really not East Hampton at all.
I watched it because Barbara
you know, had a reputation of being a very good filmmaker. And needless to say, I was really disappointed in it, particularly in the case of my partner, Jeff Salloway, who was killed in a car accident last year. That whole segment was, you know, in one respect, it was the only redeeming part about it for me, but in another respect, the way it was done, I felt it was very insensitive. And, you know, that scene of his car and the gravesite was totally unnecessary and uncalled for. Just was very superficial, you know. I felt the other parts of it, you know, a lot of the people that they portrayed as being, you know, part of the Hamptons or no more part of the Hamptons than people come out here on a day trip. Hopefully people will get a better image of what the Hamptons is all about, you know, real people that live out here, that make the living out here, and, you know.
Well, nobody lives like they portrayed it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I don't even know how people could be so gullible.
Festival, East Hampton International Film Festival, which draws a wide variety of people dressed up like they just came from safari in Africa.
I'm the executive director of the Children's Museum of the East End, and that's pronounced See Me. We just completed Kids Create See Me at the Movies, which was a project of uniting 17 film directors and 150 children, in which they created, wrote, produced, edited, acted in 17 films. We screened the films in a large field in Sagaponack and created a kind of premiere atmosphere in which we had red carpets going into the tents, we had popcorn, we had over 400 people viewing the work of these 17 directors. One of the film workshops consisted of the children meeting in a studio in Wainscott, New York, and writing, and followed by the next week visiting the senior citizens at the Hunting Lane Rest Home in East Hampton. And this is a little segment of that film.
Why do seagulls live in the sea and not the bay?
What?
Say why.
Why?
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 Because if they lived in the bay, they would be called bagels.
Why did the football coach kick the vending machine?
Why? Why?
Because he wanted his quarterback.
Oh, yeah.
So we didn't say anything about, what about all the benefits that we have out here? You know, the benefits that we have out here raise a lot of money for a lot of great causes. You've got Planned Parenthood, you've got Taste of the Hamptons, which benefits the Family Service League. We've got food pantries out here that get used.
Meals on Wheels came to us after it was established 1 year by the Rotary Club. They were serving them in the school. And we took it over. There was 13 participants. It's grown to 100 meals a day on the average. It's broader than just food. And then there are other programs that are associated with Meals on Wheels that lock these people together with the community, such as the Are You OK program, which is linked to all of our people. And every day the police department calls and says, are you all right? And if they don't answer, there's a policeman there in a very short order.
700.
I'd like everybody to remember what it felt like when your parents argued. We're here to help people whose parents have done a lot more than argue.
I'm the chairperson of an event called Artists Against Abuse, which is in its seventh year and is being held for The Retreat, which is a full-service, not-for-profit agency and shelter in the Hamptons. We work with the people who are victims of domestic violence and their children. We also do a lot of events. One of our most popular events is this Artists Against Abuse. Which we have been doing for 7 years, where we give artists ceramic plates. They put their artwork on them. We auction them off. These plates have given previews. One of them is at a restaurant called The Laundry. And then we have an auction at Channing Daughters each year. And we have a live auction. We have a silent auction.
The Yoko Ono plate. For those of you who
And you'll get to meet with many of the artists who take place in this wonderful event and whose works are auctioned off that night. You'll meet wonderful community people who've come to support us each and every year.
Let's have a round of applause for all the people who've bought plates so far, because they're helping the retreat.
Jackson Pollock's booze of choice? Macallan?
No.
They couldn't afford
whatever he could find.
They could hardly afford whiskey in those days. I mean, really, mostly beer. A little later, when we went to the Cedar Bar and places like that, then he drank whiskey.
Now, we're discussing the Hamptons miniseries, and Jackson Pollock, I mean, the Hamptons miniseries depicted a lot of young people who come out here to drink, to party.
When Pollock came out, with the help of his dealer, Peggy Guggenheim, he came out to save money and also Lee, his wife, Lee Krasner, who was a very good painter in her own right, felt he'd survive better out here. I mean, he was an alcoholic, really, from the age of 13 or 14.
So the documentary, perhaps, was somewhat of a fair representation of what really is happening out here.
Oh, I don't think so, because, first of all, they didn't show many artists. They didn't show people who work here. They didn't show people who really live here. They showed mostly day trippers, groupies, house sharers. It was a very superficial look at who comes out to the Hamptons and what they expect from the Hamptons.
There's a large artist community, very large, in fact.
I've lived here for 30 years. I moved here when I was 16. And this was a big cosmopolitan place compared to where I grew up in Pennsylvania, so I was a little nervous living here. Moving here, but it was very auspicious because it's such an artist community, and I was always an artist. When we moved here, my parents called me up in Pennsylvania when they bought the house and said, you're going to love it, Amy. De Kooning lives around the corner. And I said, who's De Kooning?
Delighted to have an opportunity to tell you about this. I was bitterly disappointed, but not a bit surprised. But what I was very upset about is the Barbara Koppel. She's supposed to be an artist of integrity. For her to go on the screen with something like that's unforgivable.
I'm an artist and I live out here in the Hamptons full time, and we are absolutely loving it.
There's not enough time in a lifetime to do all of the paintings I would want to do, having been inspired by the Hamptons.
This is an example of something that would just blow me away. I'd have to stop and look at it and consider doing a painting of it. And these kind of spots are ubiquitous in the Hamptons. They're everywhere. And that's why I say again, you don't have enough time to do them all. But the light, the way that's hitting it,
the kind of beauty, the exquisite sense of nature here is just incomparable. You'll see when you look at my paintings that almost every painting is of a place that I found magical in the Hamptons.
I thought it was an unfair portrayal of what the Hamptons really are about. She just missed the boat completely. It came off like she was looking for everything that was cheesy and shallow and wrong.
Here at Eagle Farm, this is a brand new project on town-owned land, transforming 42 acres of potato farm into a community organic project in sustainable agriculture. We've got 30 community gardeners here working with us at their on their own plots. kids programs starting up to teach kids about organic agriculture. This answers, at the moment, to all of our needs to communicate to everybody. We post everything. We're actually planning on expanding this into a big community bulletin board with information packets on organic practices and products, kind of an ongoing amount of information available to residents to help them transition to organic practice in their own yards. This is a cleaned up farmer. I'd like you to see my farmer's tan. It's actually quite substantial. And we're cleaned up tonight so that we can parade as an artist, which we are too. Throw their money around, they drink, they clog our roads, they totally corrupt our entire society, everything that we are about. I was so horrified that we had told our friends, you know, parents of our children to watch this. I was so embarrassed, I couldn't believe it.
The thing, I think the interesting thing is how ABC chooses, or whoever edited, you know, chooses to represent it is their view.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And at the end of the day, everybody's view is different, mm-hmm. you know? But I'm just happy that I know what's out here and what how I want to live.
If they really didn't capture how incredible our lifestyle is, it's probably a good thing. That's all I have to say.
Yeah. I'm going to end on that one, too.
Thank you. I'm terrific today, actually. I farmed all morning.
We were here talking about the Hamptons documentary.
Yes, the horror. But maybe there's an upside. No one will want to come. If they don't know the Hamptons before that film, they're not going to show up.
So what was your favorite part of the miniseries?
What did I like? I liked Nancy Atlas, the singer.
Do you think that these positive elements were just buried under too much negative?
Clearly, absolutely. I don't know the motivation. I don't know whether they were forced into that circumstance, because, you know, presumably a fine filmmaker went awry. I don't know why.
What were you farming today?
I have rented a space in the Echo Farm on Long Lane. You get a 20 by 20 foot plot. You can put in anything you want. I have tomatoes, peppers, squash. And my friends are buying farmland. It's going to be spectacular.
We've had a tremendous amount of support from the local people. Financially, they come in and they assist us in weeding and irrigating. It's a tremendous effort by everybody involved. There was a TV program about the Hamptons that told of the, you know, hot tubs and go-go bars or whatever in the nightlife. There's a different side to this area. We distribute to the needy people of the area. We also are trying to help anyone that needs it in the community.
We didn't say anything really about the fishermen. We didn't say anything about the farmers. We didn't say anything about the teachers.
Well, we discussed it in my class, which is right on Newtown Lane, and the students didn't recognize their native land. From the point of view, it just didn't seem to represent what's real about this place.
I think what was portrayed also is that the people that come here have tons and tons of money. Looked like it was a bunch of college kids coming out here just partying.
I was in the first documentary about the Hamptons, which I thought was completely idiotic. They didn't show anything about the people, anything about the history. It wasn't supposed to be about the she wealthy side of the Hamptons, the polo matches, Donald Trump's bad hair, oxygen bars. It wasn't supposed to be about that. It turned into that, unfortunately. It was so disjointed. I mean, people watching this in Kansas, they're going, what are they doing out there? I mean, it's an embarrassment, really. They left out the complete Latino community.
There are a lot of Spanish people, and they come to do the labor work.
I didn't get to see the whole documentary because I got bored with it.
And I would put all the people, the local people, talking about it and see how it works, like all the businesses and how do they support this town.
Without which, no one in this town, landscapers, restaurants, some retail, they could never operate their businesses.
The working people, you know, the Blue Parrot is, you know, the cook there is from Mexico, and I don't even get to see him. So that was the part that impacted me the most. The reality where this all Latino people and people we need, you know? We have a lot of needs here.
And the Indian community, I mean, the reservation, I mean, they own this whole place. We stole it from them.
Living in the Hamptons, well, one day some people came in 1640 on a June afternoon and said, oh, here we are in the Hamptons. They brought it with them, I'll say, and they were fortunate enough to meet my ancestor, Noe Donna, who said, well, looks like you need a place to live. And so he gave them the land from North Sea to the ocean and told them how they could get clams and other shellfish, how they could take the corn that he offered to loan to them so that they could plant a garden and show them how. And then a year later, they were to pay back 16 bushels of corn for the use of this land. Then they brought their relatives.
My name's Joe Zickerman. I'm a resident of Sagaponack. I love the Hamptons. I was very offended by this entire show. A very dear friend of ours passed away, Jeff Salloway. He was very special to a lot of ours. I really thought that the portrayal of the funeral was in extremely bad taste. If Jeff were here today, and we all wish he was, I think he would look at Barbara Koppel and say, what were you thinking, Barbara? My good friend Stephen Gaines, God bless him, but actually had dinner with him the other night, and I said to him, Stephen, what were you thinking? What do you think of Barbara Koppel?
It's a great place to come and just relax. If you want to party, you can party. If you don't want to party, you don't have to. There's enough to do to keep you occupied, not bored, and that's not always oriented towards clubbing or having dinner at the most posh place. There's a lot for everybody here. There's something for everyone.
And I'm a yoga teacher and studio owner here in Amagansett. For my business, I run this studio. It's a year-round business. We've got lots of local people that come here and do yoga classes. I have stuff for children as well and families. We've got some Latin dance class going on, and we have a petting zoo this summer that my son leads with a friend of mine. So there's a lot of yoga and, you know, family stuff too. But the real Hamptons is people who are working hard and trying to find good things for the kids to do. People really care about the schools out here. There's really good public schools. There's good, very creative private schools. My son goes to Hayground, which is an amazing, creative place. This is the Hamptons, a local child and a city child getting time to play.
Hi, everybody, how are you? This is Mount Fuji, and my name is Timmy. I've been here in America 4 years, and I'm working at Mount Fuji 4 years. I'm an adobe waiter in Mount Fuji. I love my job here, and I love Hampton. I love the people here, and we serve very good sushi and teriyaki. I like my job, and I love the place here. I love the Hampton.
I swam in the sea with him earlier, and now it's time for me to eat him.
I enjoy working with the customer. Finally, I hope so I can save more money. I can open a small restaurant for myself. I love Hampton. Hi.
You like the fisherman part.
Fisherman
the
part.
Fisher?
Is your dad a fisherman?
My father's a bayman.
Father's a bayman.
Yeah.
So what did you think about, the show started with the bayman pretty
yeah.
much, and there was an effort to show that side. Perhaps it got buried in a lot of the other stuff, but it was present. But what
yeah.
were your feelings about it?
That part was okay. They should add more on the local people, I think, than the partying animals, you know. It was kind of embarrassing, I think.
Yeah.
Like a lot of people we knew were watching it because they wanted to see like the Hamptons, and it was a lot of not the Hamptons.
It's one of the greatest fishing areas in the world.
We serve raw fish like sushi, sashimi. It's all day by day from the local ocean. So the fishermen goes catch fish, and whenever they have a fresh supply, especially in the summer when it's in season, we got all the fresh supplies from maybe Gossman.
Most of them go to Montauk, but you know that's a whole other element out there. It never made it into the documentary.
I'm a commercial fisherman, been fishing for 42 years.
I wasn't crazy about the people that it portrayed, and I don't think it showed enough of the real people.
I watched it for a little while, I couldn't watch it anymore. It's just about a bunch of yuppies that come out here living the summer. I mean, that's about, you know, what I got out of it. They're not real local people.
We're a big industry out here, and you want fresh fish, this is the place to come get it. There's no middleman. It's from the boat to here, and that's it. They come in live and flap it. Like this morning, I got some weak fish, and I got some blue fish from the trappers, and I don't know. I like working with people.
I'm Captain Ken Bouse, charter boat Peggy S. I've been here since 52. I came out here at Montauk, you know, and it was nice. And they didn't show, all they showed was the upper crust that's got plenty of dough and make, you know, and do what they do. They didn't show the local people what they do. None of the bubbies, the bonnikers. We gave them some time through the association, you know, they were supposed to do some things about the charter boat business and that. And they went out on one of the boats and they took about 5 seconds of shark fishing trip. It was amazing that somebody could put that stuff together and put it on national TV. I didn't see nothing about farmers or clam diggers, guys that, you know, work out here for a living, which really makes the Hamptons. It just showed all this polo ground. They didn't show the first ranch in the United States. They didn't go out and look at that, you know. I had people call me up from Florida that watched it. They come out here. I thought the same thing. They said, what a joke that was.
They just missed the boat.
I've been doing this now for over 30 years. And it's all I've ever done. And I hope is I manage to get through the rest of my life doing this. Why I do what I do? I do what I do because I was raised in this. I'm the last of a long line of commercial fishermen in East Hampton. I don't think anybody else is going to be taking my place when I'm going out at this thing. I learned this at my grandfather's knee. Of course, he's gone and all of my uncles are gone, and my son doesn't want to do this because it's too hard to make a living at it now. I like it. I like it because it's so different. You know, I'm my own boss. I don't have to worry about somebody telling me what to do. I don't have to worry about some CEO putting me out of business. You know, it's still fun. It's still an enjoyable way to make a living. You know, it is beautiful out here every day. You get into these traps, it's just like a Christmas present, you know? It's like Christmas every day, I think. There's a 14-inch limit on fluke, so I have to, you know, make sure that they meet that standard. Right now, it's quiet, nobody's around. It's really a nice place to be, beautiful place to be.
place is really, it's the best.
This is where I live, and I just love it.
Love it. I couldn't imagine, I never could imagine how I ended up here. Now I can't imagine how I got so lucky.
Well, this is the real Hamptons out here, where I live, where I work, hanging out with my kids. And I feel like I am a real participant in the real Hamptons.
This place has got wonderful things. And, you know, it's beautiful and artistic and amazingly rich in its culture. The show totally overlooked that. And I'm glad that we get a chance to actually set the story right.